please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
India is today moving towards a period of sustained growth, working as a beacon, not just for developing economies, but also the developed ones. Mindmine Summit, an annual flagship event of the Hero Group, has emerged as a platform wherein diverse groups of panelists evaluate the evolving business, political and social landscape, opportunities and challenges of today's evolving India. Since 2006, luminaries and distinguished leaders from every river have been part of this iconic event, providing thought-provoking and relevant discussions, helping the endeavor evolve with each passing year. After 11 successful summits that have attracted leaders from amongst the best of India's policy makers, corporate leaders and opinion makers, Mindmine Summit 2018, with the theme India at 75 is the new India, tried to examine how the country is likely to evolve in the next decade and beyond. Even as a slew of crucial reforms begin working and creating traction on the ground.
The theme this year is something which is very current and very topical. In a few years, this country will be 75 years. Both the world and we ourselves are carefully looking at where will this land in 75 years. Because when we were 60, people said, this is not okay. We've been independent for 60 years and we are still not able to meet the needs of all the people of this country. There is no blue book written for a billion people economy trying to turn itself, a billion people democracy trying to turn itself into market economy. If you just look at India right now, I do believe 10 years out, when we look back, this is a country which would be hard to recognize as the same country, and I mean it in a good way. There is just so much going on right now in sense of change, of moving forward rapidly, whether it is building more airports or highways, or building digital highways, connecting the rural part of India to the rest of India. We connected 280 million people to the economy who were not connected.
Principally, I come here for two reasons. The first, obviously, this Mind Summit is becoming an important think tank of the country. And voices should be heard. Ideas must be filtered. It helps us to refashion, improve the policy. You being an important stakeholder of governance, these ideas are important, and I wish to congratulate Sunil, the way this whole thing has developed under his charge. I foresee important involvement of this body in the future discourse of country's improvement. And the second reason why I come here is my regard for his celebrated father, late Brij Mohan Lal ji. The theme of this summit is very interesting. India is the cusp of a change, the new India. Whenever we talk of newness of India, how India is shaping up when it will turn 75, obviously it has to be a narrative in comparison to the past. It has to be a narrative from policy paralysis to policy clarity. And that's how we are doing. And ladies and gentlemen, I must tell you very honestly, I am an activist for my student life. And the India which I am noticing as the IT minister of India is mind-boggling. This young population of India with a smartphone in his hand is going to change India. And all of us must stand with them to encourage this innovation and enterprise. That's how I see it.
The two-day summit featured preeminent leaders, policy makers and opinion shapers who freely expressed their opinions and offered their insights over various plenary sessions, mind-mind exchanges and debates.
The question is, across these five vectors of urbanization, peripheral, corridor, smart new, smart old, pura, the simple question I have is, who is in control?
The title of the session, a citification nightmare, you cannot allow it to become a nightmare. That's my first submission. So I don't know who, whether it's civil society, business, or the government, we have no choice but to ensure that we continue with the current path of an ambitious, comprehensive system of planned urbanization. But the kind of planning that you can do is limited. You're being constrained by all manner of forces. The courts on the one hand, autonomous forces on the other hand. So what is the responsibility? As far as the central government is concerned, we only design the ecosystem. And I think the central government should confine itself to that. Insofar as land is concerned, it's a state subject. So the state government has a role to play and a very important role to play. But the most crucial element in all that are the urban local bodies. And I make a strong case for empowering urban local bodies, making sure that they are elected, that they are responsive to local needs, that local communities participate in the decision making, and the local urban local bodies have to be financially viable.
I do think that at the heart of it, there was very little political awareness with regards to urban issues. And I do believe that's something that needs to change. And I think that we can't see urbanization and rural development as mutually exclusive issues. If we don't fix the rural problem, so you know, at one level we talk about upskilling people in urban areas to get them jobs. But the other way to think about it is if we can actually encourage children of farmers in rural areas who don't want to go and become farmers like their parents to actually get upskilled and to develop an ecosystem and an economy in the rural areas which keep them there, which retain them in rural areas, prevent them from coming into cities, kind of like, you know, one of the aims of MNREGA was actually to also keep people in rural areas. I think those are the things we need to think of.
On the sidelines of the summit, a KPMG report, India Soars Higher, was launched by Law and Justice and Electronics and IT Minister Ravi Shankar Prasad, which provided insights into the rapidly changing business outlook for India and analyzed the progress achieved under several national priority programs. It is believed that the Mindmine Summit is maturing into a worldwide think tank from which the government can benefit in formulating various policies across different sectors. Turning the wheels of investment was one such subject that was discussed to estimate whether the jam trinity or other triggers can actually create the larger growth and wealth opportunities in the new decade.
Let me just set the context for this particular discussion. The question that we are asking is, jam trinity, which is Jandhan, Aadhaar, mobile, I mean, is this going to expand the number of consumers? Is it going to empower more consumers, expand the consumption basket, and in turn sort of provide an opportunity for businesses to grow into areas that they'd not grown so far?
We are roughly at a point where the foundation has been now laid. This is a time to kind of rip the benefit from the strength of the solid foundation which has now been prepared. The superstructure is now ready to be built. I mean, when GST itself will produce dramatic effect over a period of time in terms of the culture, economic performance of the businesses, economic performance of the country, and the behavior of the society. Today we are debating about very petty and technical issues in the day in, day out, and in the newspapers and elsewhere, whether concerning Aadhaar or whether concerning on GST. But these are transformational, right, fundamental ground banking changes. So I believe we are at a threshold of a phenomenal transformation, what I would describe as a golden decade ahead. So if I have to quote from Warren Buffett, I feel like a kid in a candy shop.
King in a candy shop. I mean, I think there was a Citigroup report earlier this year, and they looked at some 40 countries over a period of 60 years. They said they reached the conclusion that to get to about 7 or 8% growth, you need 10% growth in investments. We had that, say, between 2003 to about 2008, and then the crisis hit. But we've been running at about 5 or 6% for the last couple of years. I mean, what can we do, and what is the government doing to revive that?
I would caution you and everybody in the audience to extrapolate from the past. Whether it's the global economy or the Indian economy, we are going through a major structural transformation. So don't expect the investment levels of the past to be what they will be in the future. Why? because the sectors that are driving growth in the economy right now, whether it's e-commerce, whether it's aviation, whether it is logistics, whether it's renewables, these are the new sectors that are driving growth in the economy. These are sectors that are very different from power, cement, steel, some of the sectors that were driving growth in 2008, 2009, when we had the 33-34% investment rates that we had then. So we have a structural transformation happening in the economy as well. So you really can't compare apples to oranges. It's a fact that as far as infrastructure is concerned, we have doubled the pace of virtually every aspect of infrastructure, whether it is road construction, whether it's railways, whether it's ports, aviation. Of course, I don't even need to tell you how fast that is growing. Last month, we grew at 28% in volume terms. 28%. And in aviation, we have doubled the number of passengers from 2013, when we had about 100 million passenger trips, to 2017. In 4 years, we've doubled the number of passenger trips. We've gone from 100 million passenger trips to 200 million passenger trips. And obviously, we're building airports, adding planes, as I described earlier. So in fact, when you look at infrastructure, we are doubling the rate of infrastructure creation. So across the board, whether it's consumption or investment, we are, as I've said earlier, have unleashed those structural reforms, unleashed those structural drivers that are going to power the economy in a very robust way going forward.